The many tasks of product stewardship directors sometimes seems outer space work. Not only do they and their teams need to know chemical control regulations in all corners of the world, they also need to be able to communicate about it, and once in a while they conduct product hazard communication audits. We will discuss this with two down-to-earth people, Jessica Alram from 3M and Jeff Schatz from Thermo Fisher. Let's start, Jeff, with you, with an easy one. The standard GHS. I assume you have implemented all 50 shades of purple?
That's always a ever-expanding challenge, and it doesn't seem to have an end. The challenge we find is simply the fact that we are a large organization with challenges in unique markets. Staying up to date with those trends and having safety data sheets prepared in time are always challenging our staff that we have today. The biggest problem, of course, is where we do not have staff in local jurisdictions and where we have to cover those requirements as we come up to them. We've establishing numbers of standards that are compliant with our major markets and then minor markets as we go. But we are it's always an ongoing project.
Okay, and the global increase in regulation said it coincides with an increase also in stakeholder awareness and demands for safe management of chemicals. How has that impacted your hazard communication?
In many ways, it's actually helped. It's increased the awareness of the obligation we have. It certainly helps when the executives hear customers' concerns and they're pushing for us to improve our compliance programs. So I think in many ways it's helped. At the same time, as I mentioned earlier, it really challenges existing staffs and resources that we have to make sure that we are meeting their obligations.
And what are the most challenging regions to implement hazard communication programs?
Frankly, it's usually Asia-Pacific area where the regulations aren't necessarily published in English or there's official translations available, where we may not have a full staff that is available that can actually translate the regulations and put them into normal standards for us to operate from. That's where we usually find. The other areas where there's unique labeling, country-specific labeling obligations, those can be a challenge for a company like ours, which is more of a label to stock than it is a label to ship. The regions that are using unique laws that are not specific to GHS, whether it's California Prop 65, Japan, the poisonous deleterious substance control law, where there's unique marketing and labeling requirements, to even in jurisdictions such as South Korea now, which are moving towards governmentally approved safety data sheets and registrations of those safety data sheets. Those are creating unique operational challenges for our businesses.
What are the specific challenges for formulators in the supply chain?
Data. Not only do we need regionally specific classifications for our products that we get, but we also need to know that for mixtures, often which is proprietary information. So getting that data into our systems and combining it with our formulations becomes a toxicological challenge, both practical and real.
So that's a back and forth communication between you and the end user then?
Or? It always is a back and forth. In Europe, it's a little easier where there's downstream user obligations and communications, but in other markets, there's not. So it's always it's an art of discovery and providing for the need.
And what's your approach in this? I mean, are you contacting them or vice versa?
We do regular spot checks with our customers as well as feedback constantly from our commercial and direct customer support teams.
Another topic, auditing of your hazard communication programs. Jessica, why is that essential?
Well, we all want to make and sell products that are safe for their intended use and also compliant to applicable regulations. So it's essential that you have a hazard communication auditing program so that you can review the processes and procedures you have in place to ensure compliance.
And how are you preparing for audits?
One of the first things you can do is conduct a self-assessment that allows you to look at the programs you have in place to ensure compliance and develop a baseline of where you are today. And then you can develop goals for where you want to be with your program in the future and strive towards those.
And if you define the goals, then you have a kind of scope of your audit. How would you define that?
Some goals of an audit might be making sure that all the right people are included in a product review, or ensuring that the local teams are looking for new regulations as often as they need to be. And so then you can use those as goals and establish timelines to meet those goals as part of the audit.
So you have a global harmonized auditing protocol then?
Yes, we do.
And what resources are needed for an audit?
Well, you'll need someone to conduct the audit who ideally has expertise in the regulations that you're auditing against. And you need the time to review the data and the processes.
And who would you involve on site then in an audit?
On site, you can travel yourself, or it's helpful to hire a local third-party consultant who may have more expertise in those areas than you.
As Jeff said, hazard communication programs in certain regions, specifically Asia-Pacific, might be more challenging. Is that the same for an audit in that region?
It is, yes. The unharmonization of the regulations makes it more difficult.
And what are the biggest challenges and solutions when you do HESCOM audits?
Some of the biggest challenges are just the global regulatory landscape. So regulations vary from country to country, sometimes even city to city. And then on top of that, they're always changing. So it's really important that you have a auditing program and also your management systems that are flexible and nimble to handle all of those changes and differences across the globe.
Do you also do internal audits, Jeff?
Not currently, but we are certainly moving towards that direction, bringing in third-party auditors who can take a look at our programs in the major markets which we are serving.
What are your lessons learned for company hazard communication programs and audits?
The need for globalization in a team. We can't just work in one location and assume we can meet our compliance obligations everywhere. And harmonize systems and tools and standards which we have to deploy across the organization.
And I think our biggest lesson learned is hazard communication regulations are a bit of a moving target. So we need to have management systems in place that can handle all of the changes that are happening rapidly across the globe.
Jessica and Jeff, thank you very much for all your useful information on global HESCOM and HESCOM audits. If we all managed to implement this, we would be indeed super developed species.